No check tablecloths. No dream homes. No situationists. No picturesque bastides. No art of living in Provence. No accordion music. That's the sound of France attempting to do doo-wop. In the subsequent 50 years, France has attempted every other kind of American pop music, and time and again, it's been found wanting. One idiom it didn't fail at was chanson. But chanson is evidently not American. And it's not pop music. And, not quite the same thing, nor is it any longer popular. Only Sardou remains.
Ne me quitte pas.
Brassens, Brel, Barbara are all long gone. Their audience is dying. The France they sang about is disappearing. Their lyric tradition is in desuetude, and there are a few signs of it being exhumed. Why should it be exhumed, when France has the entire product of the American musical industrial complex to play clumsy obeisance to flatter with gauche pastiche? Strange as it may seem, to a non-Anglophone nation such as France, America is exotic. It still possesses an irresistible allure. American English is ubiquitously mediated and ubiquitously misunderstood. No matter how familiar it may be, it causes America to remain mysterious. It's as though appreciative devotion to a culture is at least partially dependent on it remaining unfathomable and unknowable because it's linguistically closed off. France is happily not in a position to suffer the gross delusion that the coincidence of a lexicon means that it is somehow joined to America. Without words, which are a nation's soundtrack, the ocular is paramount. You see. You see a different nation. You feel it in your gut. The less we are sidetracked by vocabulary, the more deeply immersed we are in the sign language of an alien culture. France's preoccupation with America has endured 200 years because it does not depend on language. America is understood visually, gesturally, and idealistically. Linguistic oblivion creates simplicity, a sort of polarized monochrome. The subtleties of vernacular discourse are AWOL. Allusions go unrecognized. As a result, it can still provoke awe. When France listens, the country it hears is merely noises. Twangs, grunts, drawl. On me traite de traître quand je traite de la défaite du silence. Le silence est d'or, mais je choisis la cadence. Vague, un cyclone, que dit la météo? Qui sème le vent, récolte le tempo. These sounds do not get in the way of misunderstanding. They do not impede France's imaginative creation of an America which is partial and oblique. They don't even begin to suggest the entire picture. America's products are spangled with stardust for the very reason that they are American. That's all it takes. So if a song is written in French and sung in French, it is still made in USA. Retiens la nuit. Jusqu'à la fin du monde, This captivation with the colossus of cultural imperialism extends from Yeye's teenage earnestness to the gerontocratic frivolity of governance. From enlightened gangsters to saintly cops. Technology places, place names, abstract thought, movies, can-do, management theories, jazz, certainty, outdoorsiness, talking animals, epic landscapes, sharp practices, naivety, silos that are cathedrals of wheat, silos as mute and grandiose as Charles Sheeler's. France has, at one time or another, fallen for the multitudes that America spawns, and has usually despised itself for doing so. It's been ashamed of its vassalage to this coarsely omnipotent innocent. But equally, time and again, it's managed to cast its guilt aside. Bordeaux. Mériadec was the most central of this city's several slums. Poor, scruffy, and the blackest area in what had come to be known as the Black City. A century's industrial pollution had impasted the porous limestone. By night, there was a standard-issue complement of hookers, seedy bars, sailors in drag, drugs, people whose eye it was unwise to catch, and insalubrious dogs. By day, there was a market specialising in stolen tat and counterfeit Americana. The appetite for approximations of Lee and Levi blue jeans was insatiable. Blue is mandatory in France. The noxious quaintness of the place was rather appealing. Not, however, to Jacques Chaban-Delmas. Chaban was, for half a century, the Gaullist mayor of Bordeaux. He was Georges Pompidou's prime minister. Mériadec's renovation would be one of his great projects, his princely vanity projects. Manhattan sur Garonne. Renovation meant raising it to the ground. It goes without saying that the new Mériadec was a political gesture. Politicians are forever pathetically preoccupied with their legacy. Here was a large lump of Chaban's legacy. It was also, like most urbanistic schemes of the 60s and 70s, socially dubious. Not that anyone realised that at the time. It laid the foundations of an irreparable division. It involved massive class clearance, the expulsion of thousands of layabout blue-collars, award-winning all-day drinkers, Stakhanovite pimps and dedicated apprentice dealers. They were decanted to housing projects in the burbs, places that would prove to be the enemies of assimilation, the ghettos of the future, the slums of the future. That future has arrived, and with it, a flourishing separate development. Unlike many contemporary developments, Mériadec was abundantly funded, profligately and corruptly funded. Chaban, prime minister, could divert massive subventions to Chaban, mayor of Bordeaux. The French for a backhander, for a big drink, is pot de vin. This is a prime example of enological urbanism. It was conceived with the intention of avoiding the uniformity and repetition that had become commonplace. It was the work of numerous architects over a protracted period. The variety that a multiplicity of hands ought to have brought to it is seldom apparent due to its rigid axial planning. One building, however, deviates entirely from the rectilinear. The regional headquarters of a bank, La Caisse d'Epargne, a work whose extravagant asymmetry is psychopolitical. Asymmetry is significant of republicanism and defiant, evidently, of symmetry, classical symmetry, which is the architectural mode of absolutism, autocratic classicism. Its architect, Edmond Lay, was a provincial oddball, immune to metropolitan fashion, or at least isolated from it. His life was apparently consumed by Frank Lloyd Wright, whose buildings he had travelled to America to see.
The corner window was indicative of an idea conceived early in my work that the box was a fascist symbol and the architecture of freedom, of democracy, needed something beside the box. So I started out to destroy the box as a building.
It goes without saying that nearly all architects are plagiarists or thieves or copyists. But Lay's case was different. It was a pathology, above and beyond. It went beyond mere impersonation. It was more like a case of artistic identity theft. It was as though he actually wanted to be Wright. He wanted to be him so much that he stole his soul and designed what is unquestionably Wright's finest posthumous work, a dead man's masterpiece. Lay was a ghost's ghost. He didn't make a forgery of a single work. He didn't copy what was extant. He went further. He was predictive. Just as Han van Meegeren forged the paintings that Vermeer might have made under the influence of Caravaggio, so did Lay devise a synthesis which Wright, had he not been otherwise detained, might have devised in response to this commission on this site. Edmond Lay's brand of cultural thraldom was extreme. It was willed. Chance didn't come into it. France's debt to America comes in as many degrees as it does forms. Plagiarism, homage, influence, dependence, acolytism, osmosis, citation, reference, copyism, imitation, borrowing, adulation, daylight robbery, sycophancy, envy, apostledom, admiration. France denies some of these processes, some of these states. It fails to acknowledge others. It's sometimes oblivious. And when caught with its fingers in the till and its mouth full, it is defiantly unashamed. America shares its way of life and its way of God. It bestrides the globe with confident confidence and moral morality. It dispenses its justified paranoia, its mistrust of just about everything that's not American. America evangelizes with golden arches, soft drinks, soft rock, rock-solid breasts and chipolate lips, musicals, academic patois, management jargon. It spreads goodwill with hydraulic, agricultural and forestry projects. Yes, it is guilty. But so what? It's fought the West's wars, it's seen off Nazism and communism, it's put man on the moon, it's produced incomparable writers and scientists, it's created great art and great cars, and so on. À l'ancienne, jadis, tradition, patrimoine, d'antan, histoire, Naguère, Fouquelouic. The past, the past, the past. France propagates a comforting image of sclerotic stasis, which is largely at odds with its actuality. It claims to be what it yearns to be, what it once was, a country apart, a fortress of Franco-Frenchness, all succulent lunches and mellow stones, bastides and vineyards, inhabited by les gaillards franchouillards et les français de souche. A fortress of ancient ancientness, impervious to all that's around it. That's the organized social lie which it tells the world. The world astonishingly swallows it.